11 is today's number.
Eleven.
Am I ready? I think so.
Mike or 11?
The subject of calculus has three dimensions. First, we learn derivatives. Then, we reverse the process for integration. And finally, we proved the existence of both with limits. But what if I told you Calc 2 has a fourth dimension? In chapters 11 and 12, we branch out into the world of series, the study of infinite patterns. Six examples, five top 12 mathematicians, a fourth field of calculus, three dimensions shattered, two much fun, in one lesson. I give you 11-3.
BC students, this is 11-3. This is where we really start to step up our game. You ready for this? Okay, it's kind of fun though. So, first of all, in 11-1D, we had the basketball example. Remember this one, the bouncing basketball? Okay, it was this series right here. We had S sub infinity, we actually calculated it to be 50 feet total that the basketball travels due to gravity on Earth. It would be different on different planets, of course. So we got 50 feet. That was the infinite sum using our what formula? Initial value over 1 minus r, remember that one? But what about this thing? What is this capital S sub 4? Okay, this is called a partial sum. We will also do partial sums in this chapter. And we'll also judge these based off of accuracy as well. So S sub 4 would be, let's see, the starting point was 3. So that would mean plug in 3, get a number or a decimal, then plug in 4 and stop right there. So see, there's a 4 on top instead of an infinity. So at times there are partial sums. Usually these are going to be infinite sums. So going from 3 to 4, you would sum only two numbers, by the way. Plug in 3, plug in 4, stop, add the two numbers together. And then the last thing you would do is add on the extra 10, and you would get about 32 feet, roughly. Way off from the answer. You only let it bounce a couple of times. It's way far off from the answer. There are many more bounces to go. So what's going on here? All right. First of all, the leftover. Wouldn't the leftover be 18 between those two? And there's a name in calculus for the leftover. In Calc 2, we call that the error. Not a mistake, not that kind of error, but kind of the leftover gap, like how much is left to go. So the error is very simple to calculate. The error of a partial sum is how far off from the real infinite sum are you? Well, 50 minus 32 is 18 feet, so that's your error right there. Okay, now let's go deeper into the pattern, because the more you amass of this series, the more accurate your answer, right? So this is partial sum capital S sub 15. That would entail putting a 15 up there where the infinity is. So you would plug in 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, eventually 15. You would never have to do this by hand, by the way, thank goodness. I ran an Excel spreadsheet, and I came up with 49.8 feet only after I added the 10 on. Of course, I added the 10 at the very end. So I actually came up with 39.8 on the Excel spreadsheet, and then I added the 10. So what is the approximate error? Because of course this is just rounded off right here. All right, well, the error would be, remember the infinite sum was 50 exactly, minus how far you've gotten by the time you get to 15, which is 49.8. You simply subtract these and you get 0.2 feet. That's about 2.5 inches. So it's pretty close to where the basketball is going to converge because it's bouncing very little tiny bounces now. Now, this is what I really want you to consider. Think about this. You see this sum where we went from 3 all the way up to 15 and added all those terms together and you got 49.8 roughly on my Excel spreadsheet? Okay, I want you to realize what this is. This is a sub 3 plus a sub 4 because it started at 3, right? And remember that we call this thing a sub n right here. Dot, 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 all the way up to a sub 15 is where we stopped. So the error is the leftover to get to the end. So you know what the point 2 is? The point 2 is the rest of the way. A sub 16 would be the next term, plus a sub 17 plus dot, dot, dot to infinity. So I want you to think about what the error actually is. It's the rest of the terms added up to infinity, okay? Now, note, the 16th term would be very simple to calculate on a calculator. You would just plug in the number 16 only into the formula, and I got about 0.07. So that's just plugging a single number in. This is a sum of a lot of things. This is just a single entry, right? So the next term after this partial sum would have been about 0.07. You can do it yourself at home. Here's the question. Do you notice that the next term is actually less than all the rest of the terms added together? Now, wait a minute, that completely makes sense, doesn't it? Wouldn't the next term all by itself be just that? So it wouldn't quite be as strong or as much as all the terms added up together, all right? So this next term after a partial sum should be less than the error. That would have to happen, right? Okay, however, this only happens for non-alternating series, because when they're alternating, they're kind of strange. It's like you add a little fraction, then you take away a smaller fraction. Then you add another fraction, and then you take away another smaller fraction, and you're going back and forth. This is just for non-alternating series. The next term should be less than the total area, and they start to use this stuff to estimate series that they're not quite sure about using these techniques here. Just find a term and use that for estimates. We'll do that in this chapter and the next chapter as well. And then we come to our conclusion, which is on the internet and in books, so it's not a gem, but I like to write it in layman's terms so that you really understand it. They overcomplicate it on the internet, believe me. So, the error is what? How do we find the error? Get the real sum, which is the infinite sum, and subtract the partial sum. So let's write this out. The error would be the infinite sum minus, and then let's just use this as an example in your notes here, minus, let's say, sum sub 15, the partial sum at 15, right? If you subtract those two, you get the error, which was 0.2. Then look what we noticed here. If you go to the very next term, it will be less than the error. Remember elementary school? The alligator wants to eat the bigger one, right? The alligator wants to eat the error. This is the error. Well, now twist the alligator around because it still wants to eat the error. You never thought you'd take it to this kind of heights right here, right? This deep of understanding. So this error must be greater than the next term, a sub 16. Of course, we'll come up with a formula here in a second, but that's the rule right there for non-alternating. So no oscillators, right? No negative one, positive one, negative one, positive one, okay? Now, we've got 11-2E, the problem we did before. This is called the alternating harmonic series. And this was where Pietro Mengoli discovered that the sum was exactly the irrational number natural log 2. Can you imagine that these are just fractions or rational numbers when you plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and you have to get a common denominator? Can you imagine all these rational decimals, like all adding together in this huge long row like you used to add in elementary school, borrow, carry, and somehow all the decimals come together to infinity to add up to be this weird, irrational natural log 2 with no pattern? Like over time, it's converging to the exact natural log of 2? Just think about that. That will blow your mind if you understand what I just said. It's incredible, all right? If you do the infinite sum, you should get natural log of 2. That's just a known fact that would be given to you. You don't have to find that out on your own. Don't worry about that. 0.693, that's roughly what natural log of 2 is. I just rounded it off to 3 places. Let's say you did a partial sum only to 12, so we'll put a 12 in place of infinity. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, up to 12. Excel spreadsheet, you don't have to do that by hand, don't worry. And I got about 0.653, not quite to natural log 2 yet, is it? All right, the error. Well, the error would simply be, just like before, the infinite sum, so 0.693, the end destination, minus how far you've gotten so far, which is 0.653. Now, one little twist. This, you see the negative 1 to the n plus 1? This is an alternating series, okay? This is weird, but because you're adding, subtracting, in some of these alternating series, the partial sum can sometimes be a little bit larger than the end destination. You're like, wait, how could that be? Well, remember, it's alternating, right? So sometimes your 12th, 13th, 14th, 100th, whatever sum can be a little bit past the end destination, but then the next subtraction will lower it back down, and then the next addition will add it back up, and the next subtraction will lower it back down, and it will eventually converge to that number by going above, below, but then settling, okay? So it's weird, but with alternating series, the partial sum can be a little bit higher. So in that case, here's the thing that I haven't told you yet, but error is how far off you are. How far off you are is always a positive number. You wouldn't say, well, I'm off by negative 0.5 inches if you were measuring something. You would just say, I'm off by positive 0.5 inches, whichever direction, right? So you do have to put in absolute value bars for the error when you're doing an alternating series so that you don't get a negative error because that's not allowed, okay? All right, and then when you subtract those two, you're going to get 0.04, so you're pretty close. We only went to the 12th term, and you're already pretty close. But we can get closer by going farther and farther away, right? Okay, so that's 0.04. Now, let's connect the oscillating or the alternating series, because you also have to know this in BC Calculus and Calc 2. Every student must know this. If you were to take a 12th partial sum and get this number here and get this error, let's go to the very next term, not sum, but single term A sub 13. The next term is 0.077. Okay, great. And the very next term was less than? Nope. Uh-oh. The very next term was greater than. You see, this is what happens in oscillating series when the sign's going back and forth. The next term after the partial sum ends up being greater than the error. So we can put that right there. We can even put the word error with it. Now, that is interesting. Now, see, that didn't happen in the non-alternating series. They're pretty straightforward. The next term would not quite be all the rest of them, so it'd be less than. Here, the next term is always greater than the error because the sign keeps bouncing back and forth. You can kind of do this by hand if you ever want to just kind of get it in your mind. Trust me. But if you ever want to do this by hand, you'll see, oh, yeah, that is kind of what's happening. So, in conclusion, the error, which equals what? The infinite sum minus the partial sum, right? So we'll do this example here. Oh, but we had to put the bars around it, remember, because it's an alternating series. That keeps it from being funny. So bars, absolute value of S sub infinity was the first one, minus how far you've gotten, partial sum S sub 12, okay? We said that that error, which is how we calculated it right here, should be, what should the error be? This time it should be less than, right? Because see how the alligator wants to eat the A sub 13 this time? So it should be less than the next term, A sub 13, which is different. Now, one little experiment I want to add in here, okay? One more twist. Check this out. Instead of the 12th, I went ahead and ran the 13th. I don't know if you can even fit this on your paper, but put this down somewhere if you want to, if you wish. I ran the 13th partial sum, and that actually led to an error of roughly 0.037. So I did like the very next error, okay? Notice it was 0.04. Now the error is getting a little bit less, right? Because we're getting closer to the real answer at infinity. So we're a little bit closer. That should happen. But then I ran the next term, a sub 14. How do you get that? Just take the number 14 and just plug it in for both ends, right? But my A sub 14 was about negative 0.071, because remember it keeps oscillating back and forth, back and forth. If A sub 13 is positive, then A sub 14 is going to be negative, and then A sub 15 is going to be positive, back and forth. Now wait a minute. Mr. Wade, you just showed us that the next term was larger than the area. Look at this. The next term is negative, which is less than any positive number. That means the next term was less than the area. What's going on here? Not the area, sorry, the error, right? What is happening? Okay, a little twist I didn't tell you about yet because I don't want to cram too much information into your head at the same time. What you have to do is you have to take the absolute value of the next term. And if you take its absolute value, it would be positive 0.071, which would exceed the error. So up here, I didn't mention it, but you could have taken the absolute value of the next term, which wouldn't have mattered here, and it should beat the error. So one little thing, you do have to take the absolute value of this side as well. Some students think that's redundant to put absolute value on both sides. They're like, isn't that just making it like doubly positive? No, it's not. It is necessary because of this little glitch right here, because these alternating series are strange, okay? So there's your fact. Partial sum, absolute value, is lower than the next term's absolute value, and that is always true. So now we go to letter A. We've done our little experiment. Now let's see how to apply it, because I know all my great students out there are just thinking, show me what I'm supposed to answer, show me what they're gonna ask, and how I'm supposed to do it. Okay, show me what I need to know in high school, in college, and on the AP test. Three things, all right? This is how they ask a typical question right here. So, you have, as a matter of fact, the alternating harmonic series, but they could pick anything. What partial sum would guarantee that you are already within plus or minus 0.25 of the actual answer? Plus or minus would be higher or lower. Okay, within that span of the actual S sub infinity. All right, you don't even have to know what Pietro Mingoldi proved, that this actually sums to be the natural log of 2. See, that's the brilliance, that's the genius of this. You can figure out when you are close enough by looking at the next term after it as a clue without even knowing what these sum to, because there are some of these that are so complex, we still don't know what the series sums to as human beings. We can only estimate it, but we don't know exactly, okay? So, how about that? Don't have to know the infinite sum. You can still pull it off. All right, this is how I start. Let's use the letter E for error, okay? Capital E for error, all right? Now, what do we know about the error for an alternating series? The error would be the final answer, S sub infinity, minus the partial sum, S sub, and we don't quite know where to stop yet, do we? All right? Now, because this is an alternating series, we would have to put on the bars. So without the bars, you'd be doing a non-alternating, which you'll also do those too. So what's the answer going to be? What partial sum do we have to go to? See, the answer is going to be something like S sub 10, S sub 20, S sub 15. You're going to tell me what partial sum it takes. Okay, now, what did we just learn about the error in an alternating series? Didn't we just learn that that has to be less than the absolute value of the next term? Didn't we just say that? Okay. The next term after partial sum S sub n would be the single term A sub n plus 1. I'm just taking the example we just did prior, and I'm just changing things into n's in general. Okay, now you're also going to make this less than or equal to, so here's a little twist as well. We did show that it can be less than the error, the error is less than the next term, but if it's less than or equal to, you will get to this span of 0.25 that we're trying to find. So sometimes in rare cases, you can have series that flatline and this can actually be equal right here. So go ahead and throw that into your general form. We'll throw that in now. Again, I didn't want to throw in too much earlier, okay? All right, so now let's see if we can actually pioneer how to do this without even knowing the sum in advance. Do I know the infinite sum? Let's pretend like we don't know its natural log 2, because sometimes we won't know it. Do I know S sub n? No, I'm trying to find out how far to go in a partial sum to get the proper error. Very tiny error right there. However, do I know a sub n plus 1? Could I write a sub n plus 1? Yes, you could. Take n plus 1 and plug it in place of everywhere you see an n. That's what a sub n plus 1 is, and it's an absolute value. So absolute value of a sub n plus 1. Boy, if you really feel like you're doing college math now, yeah, you are. It's the absolute value of, okay? Isn't a sub something just like the single term when you plug that in? So it would be negative 1 to the n plus 1 plus 1. All right, if you want to put like n plus 1 in parentheses, because when you plug stuff in, you put it in parentheses, plus 1 over n gets replaced by also n plus 1, absolute value. That is your next term into the future, but we don't have anything concrete this time. We don't have like 13th term, 14th term, plug in a number, so you plug in n plus 1. Okay, that is going to become n plus 2 on the top. But now wait a minute. Isn't negative 1 to any power just going to be negative 1, positive 1, negative 1, positive 1? You know what the absolute value of 1 or negative 1 is? They're both 1. You can drop the bars on the top and just call it 1. What happens is the formula automatically removed the oscillator for you. That's what's happening, okay? And then on the bottom, we have the absolute value of n plus 1. But guess what? We can also drop the bars. Because n begins at 1 in this problem, so the very first thing you would do is take 1 and plug it in and get 1 plus 1 is 2, and then you would plug in 2, 3, 4, 5. In this case, n plus 1 is never going to be negative. It's always going to be positive, and its absolute value stays the same. Okay? Now, if you get this, you're brand new at this. So if you get this, there is a shortcut if you feel like you can take it. All right? The shortcut is, remember when we removed the oscillator in the alternating lesson? We took the oscillator off to the side, and we focused on something we called b sub n was the rest of the problem. All right. You know what, up here, if you take out the oscillator, isn't b sub n 1 over n? Guess what this is over here? B sub n plus 1. Shortcut, and yes, it always works. This should always be b sub n plus 1, the rest of the problem, but with n plus 1 replacing n. So you can use that shortcut if you want to. So now we jump across the line over here where we have more space in your paper. Now let's think about this. We said that the error will always be less than or possibly equal to, in rare cases, the next term's absolute value. We proved that in our little experiment before. And now what we're saying is we can put E less than or equal to, you can replace the next term. We just found the formula for every next term. Every possible next term is just simply 1 over n plus 1. That's the error, right? But we want the error to be within, which means less than 0.25 of the final answer. So you simply find a formula for the next term. You can figure out how to drop the absolute value bars in most cases. You let that be less than 0.25 or whatever error I give you. You never work with decimals in calculus. You make them into fractions, 1/4, and you simply solve this equation from like middle school or integrated 1 or 2. It's an inequality, all right? So here's what we do. Cross multiply on both sides, all right? The 4 multiplies up to the 1. The n plus 1 multiplies up to the 1. And you get 4 and n plus 1. Now remember, back in middle school, you probably studied this. If you multiply both sides of an inequality by a negative or divide by a negative, it switches the inequality sign. If everybody's positive, it does not. Well, 4, when you multiplied that over, that was positive. N plus 1, as we said, because n starts at 1 and goes up, n plus 1 is always positive as well, so no direction change. Now, there could be some problems where it does change, so think about that, okay? And then finally subtract 1 from both sides, and you end up getting 3 is less than n. Of course, most of us write n greater than 3. That would make a lot more sense. So n must be greater than 3, so you know what that means? Greater than 3. That means if you do the partial sum S sub 3, it's maybe not quite enough. Actually, sometimes it is, you just don't know. But that means it's not guaranteed to be enough. But if you go past 3, S sub 4 would be guaranteed to give you less than an error of 0.25 without even knowing that this sum is natural log 2. Now that is some wild mathematics right there. And in the multiple choice of the AP test, they might even say, instead of S sub 4, they might say 4 terms. You know, they might actually write it out as a word, you know, a couple of words, 4 terms, 3 terms, 2 terms, bubble in the right answer. Or since N greater than 3 was not enough, we said, sometimes I've seen in the multiple choice, they'll say N greater than or equal to 4. Even though greater than 3 in real life could be like 3.1, 3.2, 3.3, that's not the same thing. Oh, wait, we're only counting by integers in this chapter. You only plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So the next thing after 3 is 4. So you might see the answer like that in the multiple choice. It just depends. Okay, I'm good with S sub 4. I think that's fine. Now, let's do another one because I know you want some practice. You want to get more comfortable with this, right? So let's do another one. Let's see if we can do it in fewer steps, though, all right? I've kind of given you, like, the long way at first there, kept the training wheels on the tricycle. Now I'm going to take the training wheels off and see if you can ride, all right? I guess you don't really need it on a tricycle, though, do you? Because they already are training wheels. You need it on a bicycle. Okay, so let's try this. All right, what was the very first thing we did other than just stating the whole formula, okay, which you'll memorize, especially for college, and the AP test? Well, the first thing we did was we took the absolute value of the next term, a sub n plus 1, because this is our guide right here. Now, do you remember that, okay, this is an alternating series, clearly, because there's a negative 1 to the something, all right? So, you remember that you can remove the oscillator because the absolute value of 1 or negative 1 is just 1? So remember my shortcut. If you don't want to go through all these steps, you can just take the absolute value of the next term b sub n, which is without the oscillator. You can do that. These will be the same because the oscillator only produces 1 and negative 1. Okay? Totally fine. All right, so what does that mean? That means forget about the oscillator like we did last time. That means change n into n plus 1. So it would be 1 over n plus 1 quantity squared. And I've dropped the bars because everything squared is positive, so there's no way I need bars on that thing anyway. So there is your absolute value of a sub n plus 1 done the fastest possible way. If you need more steps, take them. If you can cut out some steps, do what I just did there. All right? Now, fact. The error in an alternating series must be less than or equal to the next term's absolute value, which is that thing, and then we want that error to fall under 0.01. So we're simply solving that equation. And in some rare cases, the error is equal to the very next term. That can happen. We didn't mention it until we got into the problems, all right? But we're basically just solving that, and I'm going to change that into a 1 over 100. So it's often stated as a decimal up there. You will change it to a fraction. You will cross-multiply both sides. So 100 times 1 comes up there. N plus 1 quantity squared goes up there, multiplies the 1, cross multiplication. And because both things were positive that you multiplied, it will stay less than, but beware of the future when it may change. Now your instincts are probably telling you take the square root of both sides. You can do that, although I've seen places where it really causes a mess and it gets really, really tricky. I probably wouldn't recommend it, I don't think. All right, so I think what I would prefer to do, because if you do take the square root, it is plus or minus 10. And so what you have to do is you have to make it like less than positive 10 and greater than negative 10. And again, it can lead to some wrong answers or messy situations. I think what I would do, if it were an equal sign, an equation, yeah, I would take the square root of both sides, make that plus or minus 10, of course. Yes, inequalities, I don't think I would. I think I would FOIL this and make it n squared plus 2n plus 1 by FOIL. Then it would subtract the 100 to try to get this to equal a 0, basically, or be greater than 0. If you subtract the 100 over, that's better, and you get n squared plus 2n, and then subtract the 100, you get negative 99. College professors, they can plant tricks where taking the square root does not work, and so you want to just do this, I think, instead, since it's not an equation, okay? And then it becomes another factor problem. So n times n is n squared, and of course I rigged this up just perfectly for you. Two numbers that multiply to be negative 99 and add to be positive 2. Okay, well that's going to be plus 11 and minus 9. Interesting. All right. Now, the way we did this back in Integrated 3, if we got to do it, or maybe that's even Integrated 2, it's back there a ways. The way you figure out this, you can't just say negative 11 and positive 9. That's not the way to do it, all right? You have to do this by number line back in your Integrated classes. It was kind of the predecessor to the first derivative test long before you had a calculus class, actually. You find your neutrals, which would be positive 9 and negative 11. So let's mark negative 11, positive 9. And then if you plug in like 0 and 100 and negative 100, okay, this is literally like a integrated 1 or integrated 2 classic is what this is. Even middle school teachers will teach it too. I did. But if you plug in 0 for the n's, you get positive 11 times negative 9. That's negative. Okay, but wait, you want all this to be, read it backwards, the alligator wants to eat this way. You want all this stuff to be greater than 0, don't you? Not less than 0, so that's wrong. So then you try 100 and you get positive times positive is a positive. Okay, a positive number is greater than 0. And then you try negative 100 and you get a negative times a negative, which is a positive. Okay, that would work too. Except remember, n started at 1. So that means going below negative 11, I mean, you could just ignore that anyway. You could just focus on these right here. Apparently under 9 didn't cut it, but above 9 does. So the answer, the solution to this back in integrated classes, and this is on the ACT, by the way, good refresher right here. The answer, the correct answer, for where this mass is greater than 0 is above 9. So the correct answer is n greater than 9, okay? But that means in this class that the partial sum S sub 9 would not cut it necessarily. Now it can sometimes, we just don't know a lot of the time. It's not a guarantee, I'll tell you that, because it says it must be greater than 9. What's the next integer above 9 to plug into this thing? 10. So apparently, if I were to do start at 1, plug that in for all the n's, get a decimal, plus, because sigma means plus, plug in 2, plus, plug in 3, plus, plug in 4, up to 10, I would be within 0.01 of the actual answer. I would be that close after only 10 moves. Because remember, it does not take long to get to the asymptote, and you spend forever going a very minute distance for the rest of eternity. And there's your answer. Which brings us to a gem. They have this stuff, they just overcomplicate it, and they can't just clearly articulate it for students who say, just give it to me straight. You don't have to write all this fancy mathematics, okay? So, here's the scoop, all right? If you have a series, but it's an alternating series, therefore it can be written as B sub n times the oscillator, then all you have to do to find the alternating series error bound is to take the absolute value of B sub n plus 1, the next term without the oscillator, and then just make that less than whatever the bound is, like the 0.01, the 0.25, that's called the bound. Simply solve that equation, and you're done. That's how they should have said it, all right? But nobody will, but I will. And number 19, who discovered this as a way to estimate these series before certain series had been discovered? Some of these were discovered way later after this person's lifetime, but he already had a way to estimate the series that they didn't even know. They didn't know what the infinite sum was going to turn out to be. Well, you might recognize number 19. That is Leibniz, the co-founder with Sir Isaac Newton of calculus, and he discovered this stuff a long, long time ago. All right, back page.